Well, good morning, and thank you for coming out to Wayside Baptist Church today. If you're visiting with us today, you're our honored guest. Thank you so much for being here. If you haven't filled out a visitor card in the last year, and this is your first time within the last year and you haven't filled out a visitor card, if you could stop at the welcome table and fill one of those out, I would greatly, greatly appreciate it. We're going to start out the service with a baptism today, and that way at the end of the service, we can have ample time to shake his hand and during the handshake time and stuff like that. A lot of times baptisms will take place at the end of church, and people are getting dried off while everybody's leaving. So we like to do them at the beginning of church if we can, but also to kick off another Sabbath day, another day in celebration of someone taking their next step. If you're happy for Blake taking his next step of baptism, would you let him hear it? Yeah. And it was in May, if I'm not mistaken, around Mother's Day, right around in there. So a couple months ago, Blake raised his hand, and Pastor Aaron took Blake out and led Blake to the Lord. And I've been talking with Blake the last couple months and have explained what baptism is. Baptism does not save you, but it shows publicly that you are saved. And it's a serious dedication of the heart. And I made it very clear, and Blake was, yes, I want to take this next step. And I just want to say something. I'm really proud of Blake, all right? Blake has been taking a lot of steps just trying to be the best person he can be after accepting Christ, and it's just so cool to watch people grow and make these decisions. And so we're so happy for you, man. Before I baptize Blake, I also want to say something else. Today is 1 year ago this weekend, Miss Danielle Rothgib walked in the back of church and she was lost. She wasn't saved. And 1 year ago this weekend, I preached at Wayside for the very first time. And I remember Danielle sitting in the back in tears. And she came forward and she got saved 1 year ago this weekend. And Miss Danielle, can you just stand up real quick? Right here, yeah. Now, I wanna show you, stay standing real quick. Because I know you love this. I wanna show you something. This is how the gospel and the Great Commission works. Danielle got saved, she got baptized, she's been discipled, and now she's serving. Look, her and Bubba are our Kids Way directors and teachers today. Ain't that cool? It's incredible. Thank you. So for those of you who have forgotten what the gospel does in people's lives, let it be seen in one of the persons who is teaching the kids today. They got saved 1 year ago this weekend. I'm so excited about what the Lord's doing here. But Blake, if you were to die today, where are you headed? You sure?
Yes, sir.
Positive.
100%.
Jesus is the only way you're getting there?
Yes, sir.
And you understand that this water doesn't save you?
Yes, sir.
Only Christ on the cross and faith and His grace can save you. You believe that?
Yes, sir.
You believe He died and rose again?
For us.
Well, amen. Well, by your profession of faith, my brother, I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. There you go. Just grab me right there. Buried with Him in baptism, raised to walk in the newness of life. I'm happy for you.
Thank you, sir.
Congratulations, man. Thank you. And let me challenge you, if you have not taken your next step of faith, Jesus is very explicit post-salvation that He wants His people to be fully immersed, baptized. And if you need any help making that decision, any of our staff would love to have that conversation with you. All right, music team, let's get to it. Let's sing that new song, Christ is Sure and Steady Anchor.
All right. As Pastor said, we're going to be singing a new one. We did do it last week. However, I believe like 80% of you were on vacation last week. So it's going to be brand new to a lot of you. But it is Christ the Sure and Steady Anchor. If you want, I'll go ahead and sing the first verse, and I'm going to invite you guys to stand with me and sing on the second verse. So.
My sails have all been torn. In the suffering, in the sorrow, when my sinking hopes are few, I will hold fast to the anchor, it shall never be.
Now you can all go ahead and stand. Let's all go ahead and sing that second verse. Everyone on the second.
Christ the sure and steady anchor, while the tempest rages on, when temptation claims the battle and it seems the night has won. Deeper still then goes the anchor, though I justly stand accused, I will hold fast to the anchor, it shall never be.
True as that. Although we stand accused, and we justly stand accused for our wages of sin, have brought forth death, we hold on to the anchor in Christ of our salvation.
Christ the sure and steady anchor, through the floods of unbelief, hopeless somehow, oh my soul now, lift my eyes to Calvary. This my palace of assurance, through his love forever prove. I will hold fast to the anchor, it shall never be. Sure and steady anchor, as we face the waves of death, when these trials weigh to glory, and we draw our final breath, we will cross that great horizon, clouds behind it, by secure, and the call will be the better for the storms that we endure. Christ, the shore of our salvation, ever faithful, ever true. We will hold fast to the anchor, it shall never be.
Singing. We're good.
I want us to sing that song again. I know we didn't plan for it, but y'all sounded, I was standing back here in the baptistry room listening to y'all sing, and I almost started preaching back there in the baptistry room. Y'all sound phenomenal. When truth hits your heart, your voice follows. Singing is very easy for the Christian if they allow that truth to get into their heart. And around that third verse, that truth started nestling in. So here's what I want to challenge you to do. Listen, crazy people. Here's what I want to challenge you to do. All right, y'all know who I was talking about too. Here's what I want to challenge you to do. If you got hands during worship, learn how to use them. If you've got eyes, learn how to close them and think of that truth. If you've got a voice, learn how to use it. Man, Wayside has come so far in singing corporate glories and praises to the Christ. And I'm so proud of y'all, but I think we need to sing that song again. That's tremendous. Let's do that one more time.
Amen.
In the fury of the storm, when the winds of doubt blow through me and my sails have all been torn, in the suffering, in the sorrow, when my sinking hopes are few, I hold fast to the anchor, it shall never be. The shore and steady anchor through the floods of unbelief. Hopeless somehow, oh my soul, now lift your eyes to Calvary. This my palace of assurance, see his love forever prove. I will sure and steady anchor as we face the waves of death. When these trials give way to glory and we draw our final breath, we will cross that great horizon, clouds behind and life secure, and the shall never be.
We're going to go ahead and sing now an old one. Should be familiar. I don't know if it's even in the hymnal, but I believe Bill Gaither wrote it, so don't hold that against us. But because he lives, because he lives. Go ahead on the first.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus, and he came to love, heal and forgive, he lived and died to buy my pardon.
Singing at this time, Miss Ruth, if you want to go ahead and continue playing, kids, you're phenomenal. Go have fun in your own class. See you guys in a little bit. Do you guys want to go ahead, just greet somebody, shake a hand, maybe someone you have not said hello to yet. Thank you. start making your way back to your seat. We're going to go ahead and continue singing, Because He Lives.
And then one day, I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's fight, oh, with day. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know He lives, because He lives. I can face tomorrow, because He lives. All fear is gone, because I know He holds a future, and life is worth the living just because He lives.
A cappella.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow, because He lives. All fear is gone, because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives.
Beautiful singing. You may be seated this time. Pastor is going to come forward.
Great singing this morning. Phenomenal singing. Y'all sounded great. Such good truth that we're singing there. We're going to sing one more a cappella song right after these announcements. But just a couple of announcements for you. If you have offerings or if you have tithes, offerings, missions, if you're paying for a trip or anything like that, one thing that I think that we can work on just a little bit is let's make sure that we're putting all of those finances in a church envelope, notating what they're for, and dropping them in one of our boxes. I know over the last few weeks, people have handed me their tithe. People have handed Pastor Aaron their tithe. People will hand other adults or deacons or elders something to pay for a trip. And what that does is just not good optically, okay? The Bible says abstain from all appearance of wrongdoing. And so we just, to stay as above reproach as we possibly can. No money's missing. I'm not making like a sidebar comment because someone stole $5,000. It's nothing like that, okay? We just, there's always something that we can be doing better to be better stewards. And so if you could, if you were giving in-house a check, a cash, paying for a team trip, paying for a rooted trip, if you're doing any of that, if you could just put it in one of our church envelopes. There's some on the front row here, some on the front row back there, and some back there by the missions box. Just put it in there and notate exactly what it's for. That really helps us stay as far above reproach as we possibly can. Because when someone hands me money, my hand starts burning, okay? Because accusations can do just as much harm as actual stuff. And so just a little bit of workshop that we wanted to talk about there. Nobody's doing anything wrong whatsoever. It actually goes to show you that everybody trusts each other here and we love each other. But just to be as best stewards as we can, just fill those out and put those in the box, whether it's offerings, tithes, missions. Also, you can give your offerings online very securely. A lot of people are doing that at welcometowayside.com. I want to tell you about this. When you go to welcometowayside.com in the Give tab and you go to give your offering, here's a couple options. You can do a one-time payment. You can do a recurring payment, so it's kind of out of sight, out of mind. You never get tempted to keep God's portion of it. You can do a recurring payment. There's also an option in there. If you run a debit card or a credit card on our online giving, we pay a small processing fee. It's nothing major, but there's actually a box that you can click that allows you to cover that, so that's not an expense of the church, because when a couple $1,000s comes in, all of a sudden that processing fee gets a little bit bigger. So I just kind of wanted to help you navigate that. Is it secure? Absolutely. Thousands of churches. This is the leading church financial processor. We have not cut any corners. And so whether you want to give in-house or online, let's just make sure we're doing it as securely as we possibly can. Just want to be great stewards of all God has given us. Also want to tell you some personal information about our family. We were out of town this past Wednesday. We'll be out of town this upcoming Wednesday, and we'll also be out of town next Sunday on the 31st. We're just taking a lot of vacations. We're spending, no, I'm just teasing. We are not gallivanting around. We're taking the teenagers, or Pastor Aaron and Miss Anna. We're assisting them. Today we leave with the teenagers right after church. Here in just a couple minutes, we're going to have prayer over those teenagers. But we go out of town with them. We had to do something with our kids. And so we took our kids to Logan's parents last Wednesday. We have to go pick them up right after the give back event. And so our hands are kind of tied. And I wanted to just clarify. You're like, where's Pastor Levi? He's never around here. I'm always here, number one. And number two, I just wanted you to know that I'm not gallivanting. And we're not just having vacation after vacation after vacation. It's just kind of a busy traveling season for us. But this Wednesday, one of our deacons is going to be preaching. Pastor Steve. How does that sound? Pastor Steve. And let's just stick with it. Pastor Steve is going to be preaching this Wednesday. And this upcoming Sunday, Pastor Aaron's getting shoved into the deep end. And he'll be preaching this upcoming Sunday. And y'all be praying for Pastor Aaron, because over the next 11 days, you're preaching 42,000 times, right? I mean, it's insane how much this guy is teaching and preaching. And so deep end of the ministry, y'all be praying for him if you would. Ms. Logan, give us a couple of announcements, and then we're going to pray over our teenagers.
So this coming Saturday, we have our give back event coming up. And I just want to say a big thank you from all of us for giving so well to that. In the gym right now, the Family Life Center, we have tables set up with all the school supplies that have come in. I saw people bringing stuff in this morning. So big thank you for getting behind that. I think it's really going to be a blessing to our community. If you know anyone that could help, or if it could help your family out, come out this Saturday from 10 to 12 and just take advantage of that. And then we also have a second Sunday summer night on August 14th at 5 p.m. And we're having cheeseburgers. I think basketball has been mentioned. And we need cheerleaders too. So just everyone come.
Yeah. Just watch out with those cheerleading outfits. Make sure they're church approved, okay? No, that's going to be a great time. Pick up basketball. I'm excited to play basketball with Brother Joe Fitzgerald and Joe Harris. They've been, really talking about wanting to play. So, Cody, you think he's going to be okay? You think I'm gonna pound him down low in the block, all right? And y'all are gonna see how a champion plays basketball on August the 14th, all right? And so, please just look. Y'all have to understand something. I am not your pastor between the lines, okay? So when we step into the field of competition, I want to teach the next generation that whatsoever you find your hand finds to do, do it with all of your might, okay? And so if I'm not playing, super diplomatic, super pastoral. If I am playing, just turn the other way, close your ears. It's going to be a great time, August the 14th for that. Hey, teenagers, I want Pastor Aaron and Miss Anna and all the teenagers to meet me up front, if you would. So y'all go ahead and come up. And parents or guardians of the teenagers as well, I want y'all to come up with them. If you would, if the teenagers going on the trip, and then the parents that are going with them, coming up, and now do you see why you need to pray for us over the next week? I thought we were getting out of youth ministry, and we are just right back into it now. No, we're taking 10 teenagers. Is that correct? 10 teenagers. One's meeting us down there. 10 teenagers and ample chaperones, 6 chaperones to 10 teenagers. So we should be good with that. But we're leaving today right after church and heading to Lake Anna. We have, and I will say this, we took up special offerings our first, second Sunday summer night in July. All the proceeds from the taco night went to this team trip. We took up an offering for the team trip. And with the fees that the parents have paid, we've been able to, through your benevolence, we've been able to totally cover this without exacting from the general. So thank you so much. Your benevolence is allowing for this week. But here's how we spent that money. We got a cabin right on the lake of Lake Anna. And so the back deck, I mean, is just right over the lake. And we're getting a couple boats tomorrow. And so we're going to be super spiritual. You know, Jesus said we're fishers of men. So we're going to somehow make this spiritual on boats tomorrow. And hopefully our boat trip with Jesus is a little bit better than the ones in the New Testament, though. But no, we're going to have a great time. We're going to Fredericksburg on Tuesday to do some things. But every morning, teenagers will be here and teaching and preaching. Every night, teenagers will be here and teaching and preaching. Pastor Aaron and I are splitting those duties. They'll be getting up at a certain time. Y'all be getting up at a certain time, having devotions in the morning. So this is a really spiritually intensive. They think that they're going to hang out on a boat. There's a lot more going on than that. This is called our summer spiritual. And I want to say publicly that Pastor Aaron and Miss Anna have done a phenomenal job putting this together. And I think that they need a big round of applause for that. And they have it all logged down from even Anna put in there when we're all supposed to take our showers, you know, so like she's got it all down and they've done a great job budgeting things. And to be 3 months into their first ministry gig to tackle this, they've done a phenomenal job and I'm so thankful for that. And parents, I don't know why you are, but thank you for trusting your teenagers to us. But we're going to have a great time. I think they're going to hear 7 or 8 messages down there. We're going to have devotions together. It's going to be a great time. We'll have more testimonies and stuff when we come back. But we need you to pray that God would keep us safe and that this would not, we don't want, just like with Vacation Bible School, we're not just throwing a party. We don't want to just go spend thousands of dollars so they can have a fun time at the lake. They can do that all other times. We want to teach our teenagers that you can have as much or more fun within the church than you can outside of the church. It just comes with no regrets, okay? I will never let the world outfun us from this church. I want our teenagers to know that the Christian life is not boring and that they can have incredible memories minus the regrets. So we're going to have a great time, but these trips, Miss Logan and I, we spent 10 years taking trips like this and conferences and stuff, and we even have some people whose teenagers were in our youth group sitting in here today. And those trips are life-changing, okay? This is also the culmination of a lot of prayers that have come from Wayside. And I want to be very, very clear. If you don't give God thanks and glory and gratitude for what you're seeing right now, you're no better than the Israelites who had a bad spirit in the Old Testament. None. Because the Israelites begged God to do something, and when he did it, they were ungrateful, all right? We've begged God to do something with our youth group. We started praying on November the 7th that God would send us a youth director, and he did. And God has done something and is doing something. Pastor Aaron and I talk a lot about the changes that we're seeing in each of the individual teenagers. And I think that this is just only the beginning of something great, but we would be wicked if we did not stop to give God glory and thanks that for all that he's done. And so would you pray for us as we go on this trip? Would you make sure that, man, thank God that we have a lively, active youth group, a full-time youth director, a shepherd for these teenagers. We're going to have a great time this week. But at this time, I'm going to do this. Brother Dallas, would you stand for us real quick? And let me see who else I can embarrass. Brother Gary, would you stand real quick? Go ahead. And Brother Dallas, whatever the Lord lays on your heart, just pray for our teenagers, pray for the trip, however the Lord leads you to pray. And then after Brother Dallas is done, Brother Gary, I want you to pray for the teenagers for the trip. And so go ahead, Brother Dallas, if you would.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for our team management, Lord. Thank you for the improvements we've seen in the past. And you've sent us new teachers and new directors to guide our children, Father. And the Bible tells us to teach up a child in the way they should go, Father. And they will not depart from them when they're old, Father. And that's what we're trying to instill in these young people. And I pray, Lord, that you help us to do that. And just be with them, keep them safe. Give them good time, give them good fellowship, Lord. I pray that they catch some fish on the trip. Just keep them safe on the water and on the road. And just draw them closer together, but most of all, keep them all closer to you.
Father, we thank you, Lord, for standing amazed this morning for all that you've done. Lord, sometimes these single steps get lost in the process, but Lord, we've seen your hand working constantly day by day, week by week. We brought people to know you. The pastors and the leaders, we put everything together as needed. But Lord, we pray now for these young people and these leaders as they go on the trip, that Lord, we'll be able to lift up the your perfect will would be done, that there would be safety, that there would be fellowship, that there would be rejoicing in your name. When they come back, they'll be shouting, it is good to be in the presence of the Lord. We will thank you for it in Jesus' name.
And especially be in prayer because the cooks for that week are Miss Logan and myself, and so so we're having Pop-Tarts and quesadillas all week, and don't ask how much money we spent on these teenagers and their food, okay? And one pack of beef jerky is like half of my mortgage, and no, it's going to be great. Jesus deserves a lot of praise today. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. But just to celebrate with Danielle and to see what God's doing in the kids' ministry, we're still just a couple weeks away from 12 kids getting saved at Vacation Bible School. To see what the Lord's doing in our youth department, to see what the Lord's doing in Blake's life and through baptism. And God's been so, so good. He's so worthy of our praise. So right before I preach, I just want to lead us in an acapella. Y'all know this song. Words can go ahead and get put on the screen. Let's sing this out. Holy, holy, holy. This is a great song to do parts, whatever you're hearing there. A great song to really vocalize your praise to the Lord in an acapella style. So let's sing it out today. Here we go. Holy, holy, holy. All the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea. Cherubim and seraphim falling down before him, which word and art and evermore shall be. Holy, holy, holy. Though the darkness hide thee, though the eyes of sinful man thy glory may not see, only thou art holy. There is none beside thee, perfect in power, in love and purity. On the last, holy, 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 sing it like you mean it. Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Love the Lord God Jehovah. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. He's so good to us. Turn with me to Ruth chapter number 2. We're going to finish out Ruth 2. We are going to stop at the halfway point of Ruth today. There's 4 chapters in the book of Ruth. And we are going to finish out the 2nd chapter today. Hopefully this series has been a blessing to you thus far. Hopefully you've learned something about your Bible you didn't know. You learned something about the players of the gospel you didn't know. But hopefully more than that, you've gotten a fresh realization about how sovereign God is, how good He is, how gracious He is to use strangers like us in His story. We're in Ruth chapter number 2, and we're going to pick up in verse number 15. Verse number 15. The backdrop is, remember, they've come back from Moab. They're back in Bethlehem, Judah, the house of bread. Naomi's at home. She's still bitter at God. Ruth is in the field. Boaz comes, and he says, "Whose damsel is this?" Foreman tells him. Boaz says, "I want you to come and have lunch with me." So this is post-lunch. This is right after they finished this meal in verse number 15. "And when she was risen up to glean," this is Ruth, "when Ruth was risen up to glean, Boaz commanded the young men, saying, 'Let her glean even amongst the sheaves, and reproach her not. And let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her, and leave them that she may glean them, and rebuke her not.'" I use the King James, and in the King James it says handfuls of purpose. That's the truest translation, not on purpose, but of purpose. There's a big difference between handfuls that are dropped on purpose and handfuls that are full of purpose. "For her, and leave them that she may glean them, and rebuke her not. So she gleaned in the field until evening, and then she beat out all that she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. And she took it up, and she went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw that what she had gleaned." I want you to notice the verbiage in these verses. Her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. What? The object. "And she brought forth Ruth and gave to her Naomi that she had reserved after she was sufficed." So everything that she had brought back from the field. "And her mother-in-law said unto her, 'Where have you gleaned today? And where wroughtest thou?'" Basically, where did you get this? "Blessed be he that took knowledge of you. And she," Ruth, "showed her mother-in-law, Naomi, with whom she had wrought." Naomi saw the what. Ruth answered with the who. Big, big, big difference here. Ruth didn't answer her question about the what and the where. She started talking about the who. That'll preach, but that's point number 3. I gotta wait. "With whom she had wrought, and said, 'The man's name,'" good, help me, Lord, "'with whom I wrought today is Boaz.'" She didn't answer where she got it. She didn't talk about what she had. She talked about the man who gave it to her. Ooh. Samaria, you want to preach that one? "And Naomi said unto her daughter-in-law, 'Blessed be he of the Lord, who has not left off his kindness to the living and the dead.' And Naomi said unto her, 'The man is near of kin of us, one of our next kinsmen.'" You notice Naomi is no longer saying, "I'm bitter." It's not bitterness out of her mouth. It's blessing. And it's not because of what Naomi did. It was because of what someone else said. "Blessed be the Lord." Hey, this guy's related to us. Verse 21. "And Ruth the Moabitess said, 'He also said unto me that I should keep fast by his young men until they have ended all my harvest.' And Naomi said unto Ruth, her daughter," well, that's good, "my daughter, that thou, you need to stay with his maidens, go out with his maidens, that thou go out with his maidens, that they meet thee not in any other field." Ruth said, "I got all this dude named Boaz." Naomi was like, "Oh, that's one of our kinsmen. Blessed be the Lord God who actually has reserved hope for us." And then Ruth responded and said, "He actually told me to stay until the end of harvest." And Naomi said, "Good. You better not let them catch you in any other field, girl." Verse 23, "So she kept fast. Ruth stayed with the maidens of Boaz to glean until the end of barley harvest and of the wheat harvest, and she dwelt with her mother-in-law." Lord, I need your unction. I need your touch. I need your words. This is the most important thing that we could do today. What Pastor Aaron's going to teach tonight to the teenagers is the most important thing that can be done today. Our Sunday school classes were the most important thing that can be done today. The preaching and teaching and hearing and receiving of your word. So I pray that it would fall on good ground. You keep the fowls of the air and the spirits of Antichrist and the spirits of darkness away from this church. And I pray in the name of Christ you give us the ears to hear what the Spirit says, and that you bind the devil. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Please cleanse me and use me. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In this passage of Scripture, I see three things. I see a church, or the church. I see the commission, And then I see, lastly, at the end, the commitment. I see the church, the commission, and the commitment. Let's talk about the church first. But before, so a lot of times our minds will go, when we think of church, we think of this. And really, on its nose, there's nothing wrong with that. I know that there is a lot of stuff going on in Christianity right now that's really trying to water down the importance of this place and the importance of gathering of the saints. Well, we are the church, not this building. That's true. But just because we are the church does not mean you should not prioritize this building. God has left this house of God for a reason, okay? We'll talk about that in a second. But I want to talk about the church in two capacities. The first one, the church as us, as believers, as individuals concerning our daily relationship with the Lord. And then I'm going to talk about the church corporately, us corporately gathering together on a weekly basis. So let me say that again. I see the church in these verses to start out with. But I want to break down how I see the individual Christian that helps make up the capital C church, because it is true that these walls are not the church. We are the church. That is true. It doesn't mean that this place is unimportant, Miss Ruth. That is the pendulum swinging way too far when people talk like that. This place is important. It's still commanded to gather. It's not an option. It's not if we get around to it. The same God who called us out of darkness said, gather, okay? But the gathering, where we gather, is not the church. I am the church. Bradley is the church. Miss Denise and Brother Steve and Pastor Jerry and anybody who claims Christ and Christ claims them, they are the church, the living body of Christ around the world, okay? So Wayside is not the church. Wayside is a church. Does that make sense? Wayside is an appendage of the body of Christ. We're a pinky, or maybe a gnarly big toe. I don't know what we are. Maybe we're a kneecap or a shin splint. I have no idea what we are. As a church, I'll ask Jesus when we get to heaven, but we're a part of the body. We'll get to that corporate part here in a second, but I want to start out with how I see us as individuals who make up the church. Individually, our daily relationship with the Lord is found in these scriptures. Look, Boaz allowed for handfuls of purpose to be dropped for Ruth. There was no rebuke. There was no reproach. There was no scolding. Another part of Boaz's graciousness towards Ruth was that she could glean liberally without fear of retribution. Let me say that again. One of the parts of Boaz's grace towards Ruth was that she could glean with full hands because handfuls had been dropped for her, and she could glean without fear of being scolded, rebuked, or retribution. You know what that reminds me of? I'm glad you asked, Pastor Aaron. James 1:5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men liberally. You know what the word liberally means? By the handful. Wholeheartedly, freely. In fact, 1828 Noah Webster's dictionary says that liberally is given with no strings attached, is given with no eye of judgment. Liberally is just handfuls thrown down. Man, don't that sound like what Boaz commanded for Ruth? If any of us lack wisdom, if any of us as the individual parts of the church lack wisdom and we need God's help, the Bible says that we can come boldly before the throne of God to obtain grace and mercy and help in our time of need. So I see in these verses, just like Ruth, because of the grace of Boaz, was able to go into this field and glean all she needed without being scared. Us as blood-bought believers, as the individuals of the church, we can go before God's presence into the fields of His grace, and we can glean all that we could ever need without fear of retribution. The Bible says that He gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not. Upbraideth is an old English term for scolding. That's the exact same picture. James 1:5 is talking about Ruth 2. Boaz said, give her handfuls and don't ask her why she needs them. Give her handfuls and don't put her through a litany or a list of requirements in order for her to have them. Give her handfuls and don't judge her. I don't care if she's a Moabite. Give her handfuls, don't scold her. There's no retribution. God says the same thing for His sons and daughters.
You can come into my presence. I'm not going to scold you. I want you to have wisdom. I'm not going to scold you. I want you to have. The devil wants you to believe that when you walk into God's presence, if you don't have it all together, there's this lightning bolt sitting in his right hand, and he's going to pierce it through your cranium, okay? God, look, there is now, therefore, no more condemnation in Christ. The iniquity of us all was placed upon Jesus. You can walk in breathing clearly with no pressure on your heart or your mind. You can today, as a son or daughter of God, walk into his presence and ask for any handfuls of purpose that you need and know that he's not going to scold you. You know why? Because he scolded Jesus for you on the cross. Son! That's the first two paragraphs on the first page of these notes. These things are about to light on fire. God provides a safe environment of grace free of mockery or scolding. Time out. If God's throne is an environment of grace with no mockery or scolding, what do you think his church needs to look like? You're going to tell me that he's going to create an environment where people don't get onto each other and judge each other up in heaven, but down here on earth, we can be the Pharisees and Sadducees who monitor everybody's life? Some of y'all need to be quiet and go read the book of Romans. Some of us act like we ain't never read the New Testament before. My soul. God provides a safe environment of grace, free of mockery and scolding for all his children to enter into. It is there that we find the ground strewn with handfuls of purpose that the Spirit of God has liberally left for us. Because of Christ, we can be confident of this fact. How do we come boldly before the throne of grace? Through prayer. What are the handfuls of purpose that are left for us? The Word of God. Who created the field that we glean in? God the Father. Who owns the field that we glean in? God the Son. Who drops the handfuls of purposes that we glean from? God the Spirit. We can only enter into God's fields of grace because our Boaz let us in. Good night. She's Lapete. Let's go home. That's good. We can only enter into God's... Some of y'all men need to start doing what the women are doing in this church and start amening when you agree with something. We can only enter God's fields of grace because our Boaz let us in. As we glean, as we pray, as we read the Bible, the Holy Spirit mercifully drops handfuls of purpose along the way, sustaining and providing for the children of God. Man, God's so good to us. I see individually, but then I see corporately. I see individually our daily relationship with the Lord, but now I see corporately our weekly relationship with the church. Individually, our daily relationship with Christ. Corporately, our weekly relationship with the church. I want you to notice something. Boaz commanded his young... Watch this. God, in my opinion, drew a picture of the local New Testament church in these verses. Look, Boaz commanded young men to cast down handfuls that they had reaped. These men had to follow Boaz's orders. These men did not own the field. They just simply worked in it. These men did not hire themselves. Boaz put them in the work. These men had to have a certain spirit about them. They could not act as authoritarians rebuking those who gleaned. Ruth was encouraged and invited to come into this field to glean from what those men had gathered in their reaping. You see where I'm going with this? Ruth gathered what she could, worked it out. The Bible says beat it out and took it home. So I want to show you a couple pictures. I just have a couple pictures in there, Miss Krista. So this is an old painting of an illustration of Ruth and Boaz. So this would be like Ruth. She's gathering all this stuff. Go to the next picture. What they would do, they would reap, and they would put all, the reapers would put the what they are reaping, a barley wheat harvest, they would put them in sheaves. This is what we call sheaves, okay? If you ever heard that old song, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in... Anybody under the age of 25 is like, what, all right? Bringing in the sheaves. You know, you know what they would... it's an oldie but a goodie. Go to the next slide. Then they would take these sheaves, and this is one way that they could do this. They would pick up those sheaves and they would beat them on the ground, because what they're trying to do is they're trying to separate the wheat from the chaff. They're trying to separate the good from the bad. The psalmist writes about how God's going to do that, how God is going to throw it up in the air like a great threshing floor, and the wind of the Holy Ghost is going to separate the fake, dead, ungodly, having the form of godliness but denying the power thereof, and the real stuff is going to drop down. Let me say this. I personally believe that that's what happened during COVID. Not physically, but spiritually, you know what Jesus did? He does it in every generation. Jesus reached down into his church and he threw it up in the air. You know how many people are healthy and alive right now but never came back to church? I know I'm getting up in your grits this morning, but that's what Jesus does. He knows that Jesus, the kingdom of God is a kingdom of separation, not from our hands, from Jesus's. He knows how to separate the wheat from the chaff, and that's what was going on here. In 2 weeks, we'll talk about the threshing floor a little bit, but I just wanted to give you an idea of what Ruth was doing when the Bible says she gleaned and beat it out and took it home. Next picture. That's what they would do. See? Right up over the head, and they would slam it down, and all the wheat, all the good stuff would fall down, or they may take it into a barn and have animals tread it down, or they may take a pitchfork and throw it up in the air and let the wind gusting through the barns take away the chaff, and the main stuff would fall. But that's what Ruth did. Ruth went into, watch, Ruth was allowed into a field of grace by Boaz, who owned the field. And when she got to that field, there were young men in the field commanded by Boaz to reap, bundle, drop. And Ruth would come and she would pick it up, she would work it out, and she would take home what she needed. Don't that sound like the local church? Doesn't that sound exactly like what we do on an every week basis? 1 Timothy 11 through 12 says this: according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust, I thank Christ my Lord, who has enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. That's what Paul said to Timothy about him being put into the ministry. Paul understood what the reapers of Boaz understood. They didn't hire themselves. Boaz put them to work. I, as a preacher, I didn't hire myself. The Bible says if a man desires the office of a bishop, he desires a good thing. And if you delight yourself in the Lord, he will give you the desires of your heart that you need. I didn't call myself into the ministry. Pastor Aaron didn't call himself into the ministry. The Holy Spirit of God, our Boaz, the spirit of my Boaz, put me to work, Pastor Aaron. 1 Corinthians 3, 7 and 9. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but it's God that gives the increase. For we are laborers together with God. Miss Logan, that field didn't belong to them reapers. That wheat didn't belong. They just had a job to do in a field that wasn't theirs. It was all up to the Creator God, and it was all up to Boaz. They were just put to work. Ephesians 4, 11, 12. And he, the Lord Jesus Christ, gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers. Why? For the maturation of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. 1 Peter 5, 2 through 4. This is what we are commanded through Peter's pastoral epistle: feed the flock of God, which is among you. Watch this. You tell me that you can't find a local church in here. He said, drop it where she, watch this, reapers, get it, leave it, so she can consume it, and don't get on to her. 1 Peter 5, 2. Feed the flock of God, take the oversight, not by constraint, but willingly, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but you need to be an example of the flock. Brother Steve, you know what my job is? My job is what the reaper's job was. This church is a field of God's grace. And Brother Steve, we always need to remember the law of Leviticus 19. We always need to leave room for the poor and the stranger and the broken and the outcast to come and glean. Always. But on a weekly basis, look, in Sunday school class at 9:30, in Sunday morning worship at 10:30, second Sunday summer nights at 5 o'clock, and on Wednesdays at 6:30, you know what happens? Just like Ruth went into Boaz's field, and they were men commissioned under the commandment of Boaz to drop handfuls for her to glean from and take home. You have four time slots throughout the week that you can walk into the field of Boaz and know that there's going to be men in this church, know that there's going to be women in some cases in this church who are going to drop handfuls. You know what? What? You know what my job is? My job, Bradley, is to spend time with Boaz Monday through Saturday. My job is to go in with a clean heart and the Spirit of God, a sickle, and to cut, watch this, to cut, this is so stinking good, Reagan. Are you getting this? So, Ruth, are you getting this? Ruth, of all people, you should be getting this. Your name's in the book. Does this make sense, Ruth? Yeah. Are you sure? Are you sure? Okay, I'm going to go preach it back here. Let's see if it makes sense. Okay, watch. My job is to go in and cut out, Miss Debbie, your job as a Sunday school teacher, go into the Word of God, not a magazine, not a blog, but the Word of the living God. And our job is to cut out goods, Aaron, watch, and bundle them up into a message, into a sermon. And when those teenagers, son, this is good. And when those teenagers walk into your class on Sunday and on Wednesday, Aaron, your job is just to lay them down and not get on to them for gleaning. That's our job. Pastor, it ain't your job to build the church. It ain't my job to build the church. It ain't his job to build the church. It ain't a deacon's job to build the church. It ain't Ron's job. It ain't Bill's job. It ain't nobody's job to build the church. Look, this field belongs to Boaz. He will give the increase. He will build. He will take away. He's the master cultivator. He has the green thumb. There ain't nobody who takes care of the fields of God like our Lord Jesus Christ. We're just filthy, sweaty reapers who get to bundle up goodness of God and wait for you, Ruth, to son, that's gone, my soul. Someone better help me today. Listen, I need to get baptized again. Stop thinking that your Bible is boring. Pick it up. It is so full of life. My job is not to be lords, not to be an authoritarian, but is to have this spirit of grace and meekness. You can go look at what Paul said to Titus and to Timothy concerning that. And just drop handfuls. And you know what your job is, Mom? You know what your job is, Dad? You know what your job is? Your job is to take it, receive it, beat it, work it out, and take home what is needed. What? Let me just follow this out. Guys, we've been getting out before 12 the last 3 weeks, so I can't make any promises today. I'm trying, okay? Yeah, I preached for 40 minutes last Sunday. Nobody said anything, so whatever. It ain't going to be 40 today. It's 40.1. Your job is to beat it out, work it. The Bible says work out your own salvation. Your job is to take it home and feed your family. It ain't Bubba and Danielle's job today to feed those little Ruths that are sitting down there. Thank you, Logan. Thank you. It's our job in the church to just drop it, leave it, have a spirit of grace. It's your job to pick it up and take it home and feed your family. Amen. You want to know why your family's broken and starving? You ain't feeding them at home. You waiting for the reapers on Sunday to feed them. They're emaciated Monday through Saturday, and you come and expect reapers who aren't supposed to do your job to do your job. If you've got the Spirit of Christ, you have a sickle. If you've got the Spirit of Christ and the Word of God, you can beat out those truths. You can work out those truths and take them home and bake for your family fresh bread. Let me ask you this. You parents whose kids are in Sunday school, how many times a week do you actually go over the memory verse from your kids' Sunday school classes? How many times do you regurgitate what you and your kids and your teenagers heard throughout the week? Or do we just come into church? Man, my heart's burning on this one. We have to all do, look, if Boaz didn't do his job, Ruth didn't do her job, the reapers didn't do their job, this wouldn't work. And the local church doesn't work when people don't do their jobs. It's my job to just toss it. Hey, Miss Sherry, remember the parable of the sower? The Bible never said that the sower is supposed to get down and work it into the soil. We're just supposed to throw it. The soil is supposed to be ready to receive it. Man, I got to move on. By grace, every week, multiple times a week, we have the opportunity to come into God's house and glean. Workers get their orders from Christ. They bundle it up. They put it down. The reapers didn't force Ruth. That's why I don't put pressure on myself to build this church. If God wants to build it, He will. If He wants to deconstruct it a little bit, He will. That ain't my job. It was Jesus's, and it is Jesus's. They just simply left handfuls of purpose for her to come and glean. You know why Wayside's grown so much in the last year? Because they've been getting handfuls of purpose. Look, are you telling me, listen, if you always got to ask a question because of every statement that comes out of your pastor's mouth, you ain't living by faith. You're just looking for someone to trip up. I'm not saying that no other pastors in this church have done that. I can only account for the ministry in the last year. I know when kids walk into a class, they get in handfuls of purpose. And I know that when teenagers walk into a class, they're getting opportunities to glean. And I know as long as I'm the pastor here behind this pulpit, you're going to get handfuls of purpose every day. That's why the church is growing, because when you get something good from the field, you can't help but tell other people about it and tell them to come and glean from it too. Well, that's because we got a good pastor. I'm a filthy, sweaty reaper. They ain't my sheaves. It ain't my wheat. It ain't my field. I eat of what you eat of. I'm one of the sheep that need feeding. Nobody deserves glory for what's going on at Wayside other than our Boaz, Jesus Christ. So let me ask you a question. Are you taking full advantage of that grace on a daily basis? Are you going boldly into His throne asking for His help? And on a weekly basis, I know we have all corporately kind of made the decision together that we're going to gather at least one time a week, and that's in the 10:30 hour. I can't force parishioners to come to church, and I never will. I'll never berate, I'll never browbeat, but can I open your eyes to something? If you have four opportunities in a week to come and glean, take advantage of all four. 9:30 Sunday morning, 10:30 Sunday morning, second Sunday summer nights, Wednesday night, I have been begging for God to build us and grow us on Wednesday nights. Because you know when you need handfuls of purpose the most? In the middle of the week. Well, I'm tired. Who's not tired? Who's not tired? Well, I'm busy. Who's not busy? My life is chaotic. Get in line. Well, I can watch from home. That's like, you know what that's like? Choosing to always watch from home is like getting a Walmart pickup order. You texting someone else to get it, and you're going to sit at the house and wait for them to deliver it to you. No! Go to the field. When the field is open. Hey, I'll be clear. You might have to make some changes in your life. You're going to every other field. We make time for what is important to us. Let me say that again. We'll make time for what's important to us. Look, you can ask any of our staff and any of our deacons, do we keep a docket on who comes to church? Nope. Y'all don't, at least. Not either. No, we don't. We ain't going to police it. I never have, and I never will, but I'm going to be very clear. If your church's doors are open, you need to be in your church. I wonder how many handfuls have expired and grown. Watch this. You know what? I'm not even going to get to my second and third point. The Lord wants us to camp here. We're going to be done after this point. I wonder how many handfuls of purpose you have needed in that moment, but because you did not go get them. I cannot, and I vow to you, this is not coming from a heart of bitterness, rudeness, meanness. I vow to you, and if you think that, you don't know me in the slightest bit. I've always said this ain't my job to build the church. I've always said I don't get the glory. I've always said don't look at the reapers. I don't care whose name is on a sign outside. Don't look at the reapers. But Jesus, in His grace, when He died for us on the cross, the Bible said that He shed His blood to purchase the church. The Bible says that judgment must begin at the house of God. That's not talking about your temple. You are the temple. You're not the house. Hear me out. This is not in my notes. I'm just chasing the rabbit trail of Jesus. Judgment, the ascertaining of truth, the delineation between right and wrong must begin and must start first in the house of God. Old Testament, he that is planted in the house of the Lord, not the temple. There's a big difference between your temple. What, know you not that you are the temple of the Holy Ghost? Miss Vicky, we're the temple of the Holy Ghost, but we're not the house of God. This is. And it says that he that is planted in the house of the Lord will flourish in the courts of our God. Psalm 92. It makes no sense to say that that's us. He that's planted in himself will flourish. We don't flourish. Miss Vicky, all we do is destroy things, i.e. Adam and Eve. Look at what they did to their garden. We just destroy things. Brother Bill, that's why Paul writes to Timothy and he says, I want you to tell them this so they know how to behave in the house of God. Miss Samara, when Jesus died on the cross, yes, he purchased your entrance into heaven. Yes, he poured concrete over the gates of hell. Like you're safe. You're saved as by fire, what Jude would say. That's just what he at first did for you. But when he died, he also purchased you access to the fields. He purchased us access to the fields of God. Individually, you can walk into the throne. So why aren't you? Why in the devil would you not have a prayer life? God robed himself in flesh and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men and humbled himself to take the cursed death of the cross to purchase your access. It's like buying a Sam's Club card and never going to Sam's Club. You're wasting your Costco membership. That's you women who get the tan in bed memberships at the beginning of the year, but you never go. All you people who canceled your Planet Fitness stuff 1 month into the year. Yeah, I know. People are like, you want to go work out? I'm like, heck no, I don't want to go work out. I got one life to live. I'm going to eat all I can. Listen. Why do you have access? If you have access to something, why don't you use it? You celebrate your access into heaven as we face the waves of death. When these trials give way to glory, as we draw our final breath, we will cross that great horizon, clouds behind and life before, and the calm will be the better for the storm that we... Watch this. For the storm that we endure, okay? Watch. We celebrate getting out of the storm, but God has given us access in handfuls of purpose to live freely and abundantly and victoriously in the storm. You are so focused on dying and going to heaven, you are totally leaving aside the fields of grace of your Bible and the fields of grace of prayer and the fields of grace of the local New Testament church. Hashtag, at least I got out of hell. Look, Jesus came to give you life, check, but life more abundant and free. How many reapers have worked so diligently to bundle something up for the sheep of God? You don't think that pastors think about you as they're writing their messages? If they don't, I wouldn't have them as your pastor. I won't preach about you when I get here because I don't want to embarrass you, but you show his mess better believe I'm thinking about you when I get the message. Thinking about all, I'm thinking about the old people, I'm thinking about the young people, I'm thinking about the hurting people, I'm thinking about the rich people, the poor people. I'm thinking about couples and singles and engaged and new, and I'm thinking about them all when I'm writing this message. Oh man, that's going to be a blessing. But do you know how many times the reapers and the pastors and the teachers have worked so hard to get a bundle and thrown it down? Steve, only for the people they bundled it for to not come get it. Go Google the statistics of pastors leaving the church, falling into depression, deconstructing their faith, leaving their family, or committing suicide. You know what? I've grown up a pastor's kid, Miss Christie. I am one. I'm telling you, Miss Christie, I can speak from this vantage point. All pastors are really happy on Facebook. All my pastor friends would never divulge their hurts to their church in full, ever, ever. They've been turned and rended way too many times. We don't, as a group of pastors and reapers, we don't do that. We always have to be something. But I can tell you of a surety, the thing that hurts the reaper the most is when they reap for you and you don't come gather. And they got to get the broom on Thursday morning, Steve, and they got to sweep up all that hard work that they threw down on Wednesday night, dump it in the trash can. And here's what happens, Brother Steve. Yeah, or Sunday school or whatever. I mean, I guarantee you, Brother, I won't start calling names, but Sunday school teachers will feel this way too. Youth pastors will feel this way. I don't even know if this is dangerous. I don't know if this is good, but I told you I'm going to chase a rabbit trail. Brother Steve, do you know how many times after I've preached the message, someone who wasn't there to hear it for whatever reason, they'll reach out to me, and what they needed was what I just preached. And you know what? I will sit them down at a kitchen table and I will re-preach while my kids are upstairs tucking themselves into bed. I'll sit down at a table and re-preach a message that they should have heard on Sunday. I know we don't talk about this much because pastors, we have to stay together. And by the way, I'm not depressed. I didn't get into the ministry because, you know, people like me, right? There's one man on the throne, and he put me in the ministry, and I'm worried about pleasing him. I just want to be honest with you. There's people sitting in this room that go to other churches. I just want to be honest with you about this field of grace. Boaz has put all these men, and in some cases ladies, to bundle, to drop. And it's just your job to accept the access and to come in. So I leave you with this. Are you reading your Bible on a daily basis? That's a field of grace. And so much better than I. That's a field of grace, Brother Dallas. The Holy Spirit. A lot of times, Brother Dallas, I'm kind of like trying to hit a moving target on what I'm going to preach on Sunday. Not the Holy Spirit. You open up that Word of God, He knows. He'll beat it out for you. He'll give you exactly what you need. So in your Bible reading, what about your prayer? How's your prayer life? Prayer is the means by which we unleash the power of God. The effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous avails much. How's your church attendance? Yes, Jesus said, if your ox is in the ditch, get your ox out of the ditch on the Sabbath. And a lot of people will lean back on, well, my ox is in the ditch. Things are out of my control. Listen, Jesus was saying if your ox falls in the ditch, not if you drive it in the ditch and leave it there. I'm glad I'm going out of town right after this message. Aaron, you got him next week. Yes. Steve, have a great time this Wednesday, all right? So, and we'll say, well, this is just the situation that I'm in. Lovingly, that may be the situation that you're allowing yourself to stay in. Jesus took his last breath to give you access to Boaz's fields. And he said, come near and get all you want, and I won't scold you. And our prayers remain silent, and our Bibles stay closed, and our churches stay empty. I want to know what's wrong with America. What's wrong with America is that reapers have to spend all, they feel like they have to spend all their time begging Ruth to just pick up what's been left for her. Amen. Perfect timing. Hey, I'm going to land it right there. 12 o'clock. Let's pray. Yeah. Yeah. Sure, absolutely. We're on live stream. You okay with that?
I'm fine.
Okay. So Miss Lori, she visited last week. She came into the Fields of Grace with her five-year-old son.
Grandson.
Five-year-old grandson, Damien. They're raising him. And Damien's over there being taught by that one-year-old Christian, Danielle, right now. And Damien came forward at the altar call last week, and he prayed for his dad. And because he's not being raised by, he's being raised by his grandparents, I'll say that. And he prayed for his dad. And for the first time in 5 months, his dad came to visit Damien this week. And, amen. He is good. Amen.
He has the answers to everything.
Yeah. That's a good lesson. I'm trying. That's a good lesson. Because Ruth, you're not the only one gleaning. You're teaching your kids and your grandkids how to glean too. And if the fields of your Bible and the fields of your prayer time and the fields of your church, watch. What makes you think the next generation is going to care about field work? If you don't care about field work. The Bible says that the slothful, lazy man sits inside and says, it's hot outside, I don't want to go work. The Bible says that, lo, a little slumber, a little sleep, a little folding of the hands, so shall your poverty come. We have whole families in our community, whole poorly, spiritually poorly family trees. You know why? Because Ruth isn't putting in the work. Thank God she did. Obed. Jesse. David. Solomon. Jesus. Ooh, I got goosebumps on my cowlick on that one. Listen. Jesus came forth only after Ruth accepted access to the fields of Boaz. How's your Bible reading? How's your prayer life? How's your church attendance? I want to be clear. Have you noticed I haven't asked you anything about money? Have you noticed I haven't asked you anything about what you can do for me? Reapers, when they throw handfuls down, it's all for Ruth's benefit. That's why Paul said, I'm doing what I'm doing so that you can have fruit to your account. Jesus did what he did on the cross. Reapers do what they do. All those people who compiled scripture over 1,500 years, over three continents and three different languages, 40 plus authors, all that work was for your good. The death on the cross was for your good. The Bible, prayer, church is for your good. So, do you need to make a new, fresh commitment today to one of those areas? And I vow to you, if I don't see you on a Wednesday, I don't see you in Sunday school, you ain't going to get a call or a text from me. That ain't my job. But it's my job to tell you what you have access to. So maybe you need to make a fresh new commitment to, Lord, whatever I got to do, prayer, Bible, church, I'm going to do those three things as much as I possibly can. Lord Jesus, we love you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for the opportunity to preach. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And I pray that I have delivered it with grace, with your pace, for your glory. As Elijah said on Mount Carmel, that all may see that you are God. And that people's hearts may be turned to God. Elijah wasn't calling down fire for his benefit. He was calling down fire for others and for your glory. And I pray that when we think of Wayside, we would think of nothing less than God's goodness, God's access, and God's grace. I love you and I praise you and I trust you, Holy Ghost, to do the work in the hearts of men and women, boys and girls, as you see fit. I've done all I could do, and I trust you, Boaz, to do what you have promised to do. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. With every head bowed and every eye closed, let's do this real quick. Miss Ruth, just play softly. And you can, right there in your seat, or the altars are open. If you need to have some talks with God, please do that. And we'll give a little space of time. The altar's open. Just follow the Lord. Commit all we've done to you, Lord Jesus, and we trust that fruit will remain and abide where you see fit. We trust you. We pray that you'll be with our teenagers as we embark on this week-long journey. I just pray for safety and health and good weather and soft hearts. I thank you so much for the opportunity to do what we get to do. I thank you so much for the investment of these beautiful people to invest in the next generation. I'm just thankful for all you're doing here at Wayside. And we love you, Lord. We give you all the glory. And all God's people said, amen. So do be in prayer. Teenagers, please do. If you need to give them any last minute whatevers, please do whatever Pastor Aaron is saying in a timely manner. Miss Logan and I are going to shake a couple hands, and then we're going to get out of here so we can get there beforehand, before the rest of the crew get there. And we'll be there through Thursday morning. So no youth group this upcoming Wednesday night. The youth group will be in Lake Anna, on Lake Anna, hopefully not in Lake Anna, on Lake Anna. And so no youth group this Wednesday. Everybody is in here. Kids class will still be back there on Wednesday. And then we'll have a normal service this upcoming Sunday. And we are going to take a one-week pause from the Book of Ruth. And Pastor Aaron's going to preach whatever the Lord lays on his heart for next Sunday. We'll pick it back up August the 6th, a brand new fresh month, right? Going back into school, we'll start the second leg of Ruth. Excited about that. Don't forget about the Give Back Day coming up this Saturday morning. If you have any other products or supplies, you need to bring those in today or this Wednesday or drop them up at the church. Since we are going to be out of town, the offices will be closed. We will not have... you will not have access to us. So Miss Karen is the point person. No pressure, Miss Karen. If you need anything at all, you can run it through Miss Karen. And I think that's all I've got for you. Brother Aaron, you stand up. If there's any final details for the teenagers, let them know. And then you pray us out of here, bud.
All right. Well, again, we're going to go ahead and meet over here. Teens, if you are changing, I don't think most of you are, but if you are, we can do that in the Family Life Center. Go ahead and bring all of your luggage. If you want your parents to pull around here, you can. We're going to be putting it in the back of Pastor's van, so it'll be that white van out there with the Mama Life or Mom's Life, whatever, sticker on the back. So, well, sorry. It's going to be over there. But if you want to, just go ahead and bring your stuff over there. We're going to load up. And then if you can, parents, stay around for just a little bit. After we get all the stuff loaded up, we want to pray with you guys just one more time before we head out for safety and security and things like that, of that nature. Again, we'll be getting lunch with them, so you don't need to give them snacks or anything like that unless you want to. But we're going to be going out to dinner, out to lunch here in a second. So, again, just meet over there if you can. Bring your luggage over. We'll load up, and we will leave, hopefully, in a timely manner because we got a lake to get to. So I'm excited. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Lord, we do thank you for this day, and Lord, we just thank you for the beautiful weather you've given us, Lord, for this time you have given to us. Lord, thank you for that message. Lord, that was convicting to me personally, Lord, that am I doing all that I can to be binding up that wheat, Lord? Am I doing all the reaping that I can do, Lord, to be able to drop your truth at these young people's feet? And Lord, I pray that that would be done this week. I pray that they would have open hearts, Lord, to receive whatever it is that you have for them. Lord, I pray that this church would be praying for them. God, as we've said, they've prayed for a long time for a leader. They prayed for a youth group. Well, they have one. Lord, I pray that those prayers would not stop, but they would only get more and more and more. Lord, like a great fire that would sweep through that teen group, Lord, and just revive and change lives. Lord, thank you for it. Thank you for your goodness. Be this as we leave today. We give you all the praise, all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.